And we have a very, very special guest. Would you introduce yourself?
Hi, I'm Nedra Tally Ross of the Ronettes. You're listening to Arnie Amber on 590 WMBS, Uniontown, Pennsylvania.
That was tremendous. That was good. And Nedra Tally Ross of the Ronettes. And do you still consider yourself a Ronette?
I'll always be a Ronette. I mean, you know, from my childhood, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, I was singing with those girls, and we're cousins, and we're a family, and so that's who we were. We were just the Ronettes, so I'll die a Ronette.
There have been so many different rumors, and the first one I want to ask you about is, I understand that the group got together, all cousins and relatives, and nobody wanted to sing, so you stepped up, and that's how you got to sing with Ronnie and Estelle. Is
nope.
That true?
It's not true. I tell you, there are a lot of stories, but that was a new one for me. Thank you, Arnie, very much. No, actually, it was. It was cousins. We had a boy cousin that was 6. I was 10, Ronnie was 12, Estelle was 14, you know, that kind of thing. I had a cousin, Elaine and Diane. So it actually was like 5 girls and 1 boy, and then our young boy cousin, who has a fantastic voice still today, Luther Vandross, can't do him in. We did the Apollo Theater, and he got nervous and didn't want to go out, and so then it was like, the girls all went out, and then from that, we won, actually, the amateur hour at the Apollo, which is a scary thing to do, but they were good to the kids. From that, my 2 cousins, they were sisters, Diane and Elaine, they dropped out, and of course, the boy had dropped out, so then it was the 3 of us. So that's when we began to really then do the thing of dressing all alike, doing auditions from, like I said, when I was 13, 14 years old, in New York City. So that's a pretty big city to try and make it in. So only by the grace of God that we did. We went to the Peppermint Lounge dressed alike because we were singers, and we were just hoping to get in there to the Peppermint Lounge. And they thought that we were an act that was performing that night, so there was always a line at the Peppermint Lounge. So they came, got us, pushed us up front, took us through, and from there we just said, we got it, let's do something. So we got up on the stage, gave a song to sing, and did it.
So how important was Joey D to your early success?
Joey D was, it wasn't so much to our success, I wouldn't say. I mean, he's a great guy. He was really doing it at the Peppermint Lounge. The owners of the Peppermint Lounge wanted us to go to, now this is 61, so this was on my Christmas break in 61, it's from school. We went to Miami Beach to open up and perform at the Peppermint Lounge on 79th Street, Causeway. So in the sense of we didn't go there with Joey, the management sort of said, you guys are really good, we have another place down there that we want you to go perform at. And so it was sort of from that we began to really get out there and do more club-type things. We did a lot with Clay Cole, was a big part in our lives. We did a review with him and Lionel Hampton. We performed with him, like, in upstate in the where the country clubs were. And so we did a lot of that. And then we got a recording contract at, I was 15, with Cold Pix Records. And then from that, we did a couple of years of just going like places like Philadelphia, doing shows, Boston, down to Jersey Shore, things like that. And by the time I was 17, the story has been crazy things. But the truth of the story about Phil Spector, Estelle did not make a phone call in New York City and happen to get Phil Spector out of 8 million people on the phone. It didn't happen that way. He came to see us at the Brooklyn Fox Theater. We were doing the big rock and roll show. It was the Christmas rock and roll show at the Fox Theater. Murray the K was the the main disc jockey, and then we were the and others. Mary the K and others. So others being all of the different acts. So he came backstage, was really impressed with us. I mean, we had heard of him, but it wasn't like anything major, major, major. But from that, we ended up in May signing a contract with him. I was underage. I was 17. So my mom had to sign for me with the girls to a contract with Philly's Records. And from that, it's all history. So I would say, even though a lot of things have gone down with Phil Spector, he was a major part of us going, like, international.
Okay, before we go on with Spector, let's go back to Colpix for just a moment. What was your first release? You Came, You Saw, You Conquered?
I'm Gonna Quit While I'm Ahead, Silhouette, a bunch of those songs that were, you know, we were basically, they were good for us in that they gave us a record to go out and say, here's our record. Because you can do a lot of singing and do a lot of talking, but unless you have a record in your hand to go to the radio stations. Murray the K was a big pusher for us in New York City, because then he wanted to sort of claim us as his dancing girls, because we did dance. So that was one of the things that was a little bit different for the Ronettes than a lot of the groups that was out there, like the Shirelles or, you know, the Chantels and things like that, that we danced. So we were known sort of on the radio doing as his singing girls, Ronettes, but doing the Brooklyn Fox, then going up and down the East Coast. But once we got further on, then we were international.
Okay. What was it like to be on Bandstand for the first time?
Dick is such a nice guy. Dick Clark, he made us totally comfortable, but you knew that that was a major step in your career, because it was like the Bandstand show that, you know, featured a lot of artists. The young people were going to get to see you. And we did Jerry Blavitz there in Pennsylvania, too. But Dick was just a wonderful, soft, easygoing guy that actually we ended up doing a 30-day tour with him. So, I mean, we loved him. He thought we were the best, and he was very encouraging to us.
Okay, what was your first hit, Nedra?
The first true hit was Be My Baby.
Okay, and that was what, 63?
Yep, mm-hmm.
Okay, now...
63.
Was that your first release on Philly's?
Yes.
Okay. Had Phil started to show an extra interest in Ronnie at that point?
Not right at the beginning, no. It was probably a little further on where, you know, he was just showing, you know, sort of not favoritism so much, but like, well, we need to go over this, and I'll just do Ronnie's part here, and you can do this here, and... then it was like, oh, well, you just got that feeling of... Actually, I spoke to Ronnie about it because Phil was married at that point. And, I mean, we had just not been raised to say, even consider dating somebody that was married. So it was on the down low, even as far as we were concerned, a lot of sides of it, because it wasn't... I didn't feel it was acceptable.
Okay, I just lost my train of thought. And what was it like, senior moment, you know how it is. What was it like touring? I know you said that you were underage. You always had to have a chaperone with you, didn't you?
We always had. The Ronettes, I was just telling my husband this morning, my husband Scott Ross, who was with WINS, and I met him actually when I was 16, so I couldn't consider him. He was a bit older than me. Because we came from a large family, my mother is one of seven sisters and seven brothers. So then you take all those people and then they marry. So you've got, you know, 14 of each group, aunts and uncles. So father, all of those things. We traveled with uncles. We traveled with at least one to two females, which would be an aunt or a mother. So We were protected from a lot of the stuff that could have happened to us. We didn't do the, you know, even when we did the Dick Clark tour, we traveled with a chaperone. So we were protected. We were out there, but we had a sheltered life in a lot of ways.
Knowing or having talked with many of the female groups, they always say that the guys would always make sure that you were taken care of. You were like little sisters to a lot of the performers. Is that a true statement?
Yeah, a lot of it was. I mean, it's not that we didn't think there were guys that were cute, you know. When the Searchers came over from England, I thought Frank of the Searchers was cute, and I thought this one, Ricky of the Vibrations, was cute. But we really, you were just working, and so you weren't sitting there trying to think of who am I going to date. And like I said again, you've got family that you're traveling with, so it's not like you're just on your own to do what you want to do. And the boys weren't on their own to just say, oh, well, I'm coming into your dressing room and sit and talk with you. It was like, excuse me? Tony Orlando tells the story of he would try and come to our dressing room like just enough time before the shows. We used to do Palisades Park together in Jersey. And he said, I would try and get to the door, and there would be one of your aunts or your mother or somebody stopping me. And then he proceeds to tell me, I was in love with you. I said, no, you weren't. He said, Nedra, I was in love with you. I had no clue. So there were certain things we had no clue about, then there were other things we thought guys were cute, but I didn't have a boyfriend that I would say was here, there, that kind of thing. I did have a California boyfriend once, but you only got to see him when you went to California.
Okay. When you were touring 63, 64, did you run into a lot of problems in the South with the racial problems?
You know, it's crazy. Because we were from New York, we just did not think that way. And we did not do a lot of shows in the South. Really, the only show that I can say that I can remember in the South was the Peppermint Lounge. That was on Miami Beach. I mean, we went in, they wanted us. We were from New York, and they wanted us bad, and we did the show. We had nothing going on there. We had family that lived in Miami, so that's where we stayed. So we weren't like saying, oh, hotels. Now, we did run into it a bit, just the whole tour, when we did the Dick Clark tour, where, you know, it was like 30 days of, I can't even tell you all the places we went, but it was 30 days worth of places, where there were a few stops where, we had two busloads of rockers, and then it was like, well, you know, the promoters would go in, blah, 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 and some of the racism came up, but not in our face. Because then Dick was like, you don't accept them or everybody, you don't accept any of us. So we did not do what even some people call the Chitlin' Circuit. Maybe that was because we were New York, whatever. So our base of shows was the Northeast.
Did you ever get to play Pittsburgh?
I don't remember ever playing Pittsburgh, no.
I don't remember ever seeing or hearing the Ronettes come there.
I don't remember all the places, but like I said, 30 days with Dick. So if we did it, I don't remember. And when you went in, you know, you, like I said, we were on two Greyhound buses. So we went in, did a show, and then headed out to the next place if we had to get there the next day. So, no, I don't remember ever doing Pittsburgh. But we did do Philly, New York, Boston, then, you know, like I said, up New York way, upstate New York, Jersey. We ran into a situation in Jersey where we were in Wildwood, and so we did a weekend at a big club at the ocean there. And I guess it was just a sellout. So they were like, oh, well, you did a good job. You're going to stay for another week. And we were like, no, you know, this is not it. And it turned out it was more the mafia that was saying, you're going to do this. But there we were traveling with my little redheaded aunt that was 5'2", which was a fireball. And so when they were like, yes, you are going to do this, you're going to do another show, and they weren't talking about negotiating another price or higher price or anything like that. And she said, in front of them, she said to one other of my aunts, I think it was, she said, call the uncles. And so they were like, who are the uncles? Well, we had tons of uncles that were very young at that point, in their 30s and 40s. And so they were like, okay, let's just talk this out. So that's the only thing we ran into where someone saying you're going to do something or you're not going to do something. It was that we were going to do another week of shows and up against the mafia. And we did it. So we have a star, a walk of fame there in Wildwood, New Jersey now.
We're talking with Nedra Tally Ross of the Ronettes. And Nedra, who were some of your early influences? Who encouraged you, or who did you like to sing like, or who did you like to listen to?
Okay, my family is very, very broad in their music. And so we grew up on Patti Page, the Andrews Sisters, Dinah Washington, What a Difference a Day Made. I mean, that made an impression to me. I think I was 14 when that came out. And it was sort of the beginning of love. And then Jimmy Clanton, Just a Dream, loved it. Connie Francis, Lena Horne was a very, very big influence in my life. I guess I wanted to look like her. I wanted to carry myself like her, that kind of thing on stage. I heard she was a pistol off stage, but anyway, she looked beautiful on stage. So it was pretty, very, very broad. Bing Crosby, I don't know, we listened to black, white. I listened to rhythm and blues predominantly. New York City played so much music that the Four Seasons loved their stuff. Then we began to work with certain people that we love. Temptations, Supremes. I was influenced by the Shirelles, very much so. The Chantels with Maybe. Played that song at least 1,000 times. Bobby Blue Bland. So it's hard to say I had a broad base to draw from.
Okay, let's go back to 1963 again. And you had your first big hit with Be My Baby. Then came the Christmas album. Tell us about it. It should have been a whole lot bigger, but the timing with it being released November 22nd of 63, the day that Kennedy got assassinated,
right,
I think put a big damper on that. But what are your recollections about the Christmas album?
Well, speaking of the November of 63, we were in Dallas when Kennedy was assassinated. We were waiting for him at the hotel. We were doing the Dick Clark tour. And so that very much affected everyone's life. So when the album did come out, yes, there was so much going on in our world. Our world was shaken in so many ways to the core. So Christmas, the album, we were like, okay. We weren't really looking at the numbers so much. It was just like what was going on around us. Yet, the Christmas album did become a classic. So I think the sound was held its own in that it was different. It was strong. It was that wall of sound. It was a great time doing the album together out in California with everybody. Not a failure. It was very much a success. That so, you know, many generations have grown up listening to those songs. We hear it in the movies, Goodfellas, or different. Today, you know, you still get Ronette Christmas album being played in the store. It's crazy to walk through the grocery store and hear your Christmas album playing at Christmas time, or, you know, your records.
Now, did you get to sing on any other group's songs on the album? There's a lot of stories going around that everybody sang.
Yeah, well, what would be is you'd all be in the studio, and so it wasn't that you were the singers on it. It was just like when they were doing something, you could go up, maybe, you know, one person would do some clapping, another person would do ooh, ahs, you know, with other artists. But no, it was, we did what we did, they did what they did. But then for, it was, I think that was more with Darlene, with Love, and then the Crystals, and she was part of the Bobby Tots and the Blue Jeans and stuff like that. But yeah, we just had a party. You know, the Brian Wilson, their group, you know, they
were
there in the studios, the Beach Boys, they were there in the studio. So there was always really looking at the numbers so much, it was just like what was going on around us. Yet, the Christmas album did become a classic. So I think the sound was held its own in that it was different. It was strong. It was that wall of sound. It was a great time doing the album together out in California with everybody. It was not a failure. It was very much a success. That so, you know, many generations have grown up listening to those songs. We hear it in the movies, Goodfellas, or different. Today, you know, you still get Ronette Christmas album being played in the store. It's crazy to walk through the grocery store and hear your Christmas album playing at Christmas time, or, you know, your records.
Now, did you get to sing on any other group songs during on the album? There's a lot of stories going around that
sang. Yeah, well, what would be is you'd all be in the studio, and so it wasn't that you were the singers on it. It was just like when they were doing something, you could go up, maybe, you know, one person would do some clapping, another person would do ooh, ahs, you know, with other artists. But no, it was, we did what we did, they did what they did. But then for, it was, I think that was more with Darlene, with Love, and then the Crystals, and she was part of the Bobby Tots and the Blue Jeans and stuff like that. But yeah, we just had a party, you know, the Brian Wilson, their group, you know, they
the
were
Beach
there
Boys.
In the studios, the Beach Boys, they were there in the studio. So there was always people standing around. Cher and I actually were the same age. And so Cher and I and would go run around in California. And I remember in a convertible, we were sitting, this is when people didn't have to sit in seatbelts. We were sitting on the back hood of the car with scarves flapping in the wind and singing to the top of our voices. So, yeah, we hung out together. A lot of people hung out together, did stuff together, sang together. But, I mean, Sonny was the promoter at that point. But, you know, then Nino Tempo was the someone that I did end up dating. And then he was the sax player, you know. So it was a connection there for a lot of people.
Okay, let me make sure that I understood you right. Did you say that the Beach Boys were in the studio when you recorded the Christmas album, or just hanging around?
No, it was the like "Be My Baby," some of the regular
songs. Oh,
the Christmas album, not the Christmas album.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Do you know that Brian Wilson announced every day of his life he starts his morning with it blasting "Be My Baby" for all of these years? Now, is that crazy? Is that somebody loving your song?
Well, Brian has done some strange things. I've never had the pleasure of talking with him.
Very talented.
I've had the pleasure of spending time with Mike Love and Bruce Johnston, but never had a chance to get near Brian yet, but I hope to do that sometime.
Yeah.
Okay, one more question about the Christmas album. Having talked with Dee Dee Kennebrew of the Crystals, she was a little bit upset. That seemed like the Crystals got the kiddie songs, I believe is how she put it. Were you disappointed in the choice of songs that you got to do on the album?
No, not at all. I mean, I didn't even think of what, I've got to think to what were their songs. I didn't think of it as kiddie songs. I mean, it was Christmas songs, and so I guess I think of Christmas as young, you know, but no, I never heard that before. I'm sorry that she felt that way. I thought they did a great job.
Well, yeah, they thought, I'm pretty sure it was Dee Dee who told me that, but they thought that because they were the youngest of the group, or youngest people in the group that they got treated more childish than some of the other more adult groups, if that's a good way of putting it?
I don't know. I don't think that. I mean, most of the time I was the youngest that was going around. I think they're a bit older than me. So I definitely didn't think of them as being younger or kiddie or anything else. I mean, Phil made the decision on who was doing what songs. So, I mean, it wasn't like, oh, here's, you know, 12 songs, pick out, you know, three you want to do. It was, this is what you're doing, this is what they're doing, that kind of thing. So I never thought of it being kiddie or them being younger than us, in me anyway.
Okay, what is your biggest song, Be My Baby?
Yes. Be My Baby was the song, I think, that took us from being New York, but New York is a big place, so it's not like Earmuff, Arkansas. I'm not saying that. You know, New York, to make it in New York was major. But Be My Baby then made it that, you know, our songs are being played in Japan and all over the world. So, yeah, that was the clincher for us.
Do you have a favorite of all the Ronette songs?
I like Best Part of Breaking Up. I like Do I Love You. Of course, I love Be My Baby. Baby, I Love You is a fun song. I never thought that we had really good dance songs. I love to dance, and Be My Baby was not a dance song. You listen to it, but it was just not a dance song. I felt like, you know, Martha and the Vandellas had Heat Waves, so I was always, you know, just going crazy dancing with their songs, but not our songs. So our songs made an impression. I mean, the fact that it's, you know, in the Library of Congress, that they've got, you know, Be My Baby, that it set a sound for a generation of people is great. But I didn't think that I would have loved to have had a really good dance song.
Okay, I'm going to put you on the spot with one song. Tell me about Soldier Baby of Mine. Do you have any recollections of it?
Yeah, I was actually, I just listened to that because we did a duet with it, Ronnie and I. I did the harmony for that. If you listen to it, it's a duet.
Okay.
Loved it.
Now, did you ever get to sing lead on any of the Ronette songs?
No, I didn't. Mm-mm. You know what that was, too? If you've got a sound that's working, we were the Ronettes, so I guess I didn't feel insecure in that. We were R.O. Ronnie, N.E. Nedra, E.S. Estelle. We've been raised together, sang together. If you've got a song that's working with a particular voice, you don't say, oh, well, let me change it up and let me do this or this or that. I was the strong dancer for the Ronettes. So it was more in our performances when it came to dancing, and I did the directing of the band. So I felt like I had a crucial part to play in who we were in clubs, you know. Yeah, when we did club dates where you were doing a 45-minute show, then we did do a variety of stuff. Estelle did lead, Ronnie did lead, I did lead. But as far as for the records and the sound, no, we weren't changing it. Yeah, and when we did the Beatle tour, I sang lead because Ronnie didn't do it.
Okay, tell us about the Beatle tour. What was it like to tour with them?
We had met the Beatles prior. When we went to England in 64, I turned 18 while I was there. So while I was there, we were told there's this group called the Beatles, and they would love to meet you. Well, it was just a group, you know, but apparently they were sort of big over there. And so we met them prior with a private party with some of our promoters over in England. We went someplace. It was a house that we were at, and we had a party. Now, people would think, oh, the Ronettes and the Beatles got together for this party, and so then there's all this talk afterwards that, you know, Ringo liked Nedra. No, he didn't. He was very nice. We had fun together. John we didn't do anything but act crazy with each other in that fun crazy, innocent crazy, because when you're a singer, you really don't get a chance to have outside situations. So for us, it was another group that you would work with. So when we met them, we had a great evening, fun, laugh, literally running through the house. What game it was, I can't even tell you. But so we met them there. Then when the Stones, we actually were opening for us when we went to England. So when the Beatle tour came about, the Stones were coming to America too. So it was like both groups wanted us to work with them. And my husband actually had been with the WINS and all that. Scott, he was like, okay, let's look at the two. The Beatles are probably going to be your biggest group. That would probably be the best tour to take. But we made our own decision to tour with the Beatles, but we knew the Stones and we knew the Beatles. Now, I did date Brian of the Rolling Stones.
And Brian Jones.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I did date him. And Ronnie dated Keith. But like I said, you would tend to date who you worked with because that's all you did. Your weekends were working. So it wasn't like the local boy. My first local boyfriend that I ended up marrying, you know, when I was 21, we're still together. We're going towards our 50th anniversary. So I only had one local New York City boy, Scott Ross.
Well, congratulations. I'm working on 47 come July.
Okay.
So I know what you mean to have that one and only, so to speak.
Yep. So, I mean, I live a very, very blessed life. Like I said, we're going to be celebrating 50 years in March. We have two girls, two boys. We have 9 grandkids. They all live in the same area that we're in. So I have them at my availability all the time. I love it. My husband and I travel. He's in television. He does Scott Ross specials. So we're heading out to Israel, Philippines in the next 2 months or so. I do more traveling now than I did during the Ronette days. So my life, I live on a lake, and I look at the beauty of it, and I see God's goodness to me every day.
Are you totally retired from singing now?
No, I still do sing. I still do, but it's not like I don't do it to make a living. Before, it was very tiring. I mean, after the Dick Clark tour, backing up here, after the Dick Clark tour, I said, you know what, this is not for me. There were so many groups that stayed out there that did those staying, hitting it. The Ronettes only worked on the weekends. So, I mean, we did not have, except for the couple of tours that we did. We did one Midwest tour, England, Ireland, things like that. But we did not work ourselves crazy. And so even then I was like, I was very family oriented. My mom, my dad, my brother. I wanted to be home. I did not want to be out there and work myself to death. And we didn't have a company. Phil Spector was not our manager. People would say that. Oh, he was your manager. No, he wasn't. He was our producer. Record company business, but not our manager. So I was like, now I can go. If I want to go sing someplace, I can do that. I travel with my husband. I sing other places, other countries. If I want to do a rock and roll something here, I do that. But, yeah, I don't have to do it as a living. I enjoy it, but it's not my life.
Well, are you working on any other current projects? I know your husband was into the TV, the PTL Club, was it?
No. We've been with Christian Broadcasting Network.
Okay.
That was the first non-secular situation that my husband worked for, and it was a Christian television station with the early days of CBN. From there, we went on ourselves upstate New York, and my husband had radio stations across the whole upstate New York from Buffalo to Albany, that was CBN, that they sent him up there. So we did that. Out of that, we had a Christian community, not a commune, but a community, and out of that we had up in Ithaca, where Cornell University and Ithaca College is, and from that we had a theater, a school that is still going. Our daughter was the first student there, a private school. This private school is still going. I mean, so we did a lot of different things. And then, Scott, we developed the Scott Ross Show, which my husband was going to 185 stations, quite a few nations that it was going to. So we've always been in the spotlight in some way. He was ACE Awards for top interviewer, cable TV, and was up against Dick Cavett, Larry King, you know. So he stayed, he went into the television radio side of it. I recorded, like, in one contemporary Christian album in the late 70s. So, no, we've stayed very much out there, actually, doing and hitting more now, 265 nations that his specials can go to, So, and he's known as Scott Ross Specials. And so, I mean, he does what he does, and I travel with him, and we go to Hawaii and all these wonderful things. And so I can't complain about my life. I have more that I do now in a lot of ways than the Ronette days.
Okay, one final question, because we're starting to run a little bit low on time. But is there anything that you still want to accomplish that you haven't accomplished in your professional life?
You know what? We talked about that recently. I have nothing on a bucket list that I haven't done, because I've done so much. I wanted to own restaurants. I owned rib restaurants in New York, Atlanta, and Virginia. I love housing in the sense of architecture. I've owned many, many homes and still own. And so I get to knock a wall down, do what I want to do with it, or just... So business-wise, I've just stayed busy. I had a clothing line. I had a barbecue sauce line. So I've done everything. I've been to the Rockies. I've been to Switzerland, all over the world. It's sad to say I can't, and we tried to figure out where we would want to go. We have a place in Hawaii we go to every year. So it's like, I don't know. There's nothing that I can honestly say that I never got to do. Because if anything, at times I have to fight feeling guilty for all the things that has come my way. And I know it's because God has blessed me in a special way. But at a very young age of 21, I knew that there was a God, and he had my life in his hands. And so I have been more than blessed.
Well, before I let you go, I want to say one thing. I want to give a special thanks to Miss Kay Krebs of the Pixies,
yes.
3 for getting this set up. Kay had told me that she had talked with you and that she was going to get it set up that we would get a chance to talk on the air. And I want to thank Kay publicly for doing that. And thank you so much for all the time that you have given me.
Okay.
Okay, before I let you go, I want you to play disc jockey.
And okay.
We are going to have you introduce a song that you sang a duet with Ronnie. If you'll do,
okay.
We're going to play Soldier Baby of Mine instead of Be My Baby.
That's great. You know, there was a war going on at that time, Vietnam War, so it meant a lot.
Well, Nedra, I thank you so much, and if you would do the honors of introducing that, we want to play for our listening audience.
I would love for you to listen to right now, Soldier Baby of Mine.
Soldier Baby of Mine, way across the sea, they've taken you through, away from me.
Yeah.
The Ronettes and Soldier Baby of Mine, and our special thanks to Nedra Talleyrand for our Ronette, and great voice, just a lot of fun to be around. We need to do this and be right back.